Our next speaker is Fatih Dinç from Stanford University Applied Physics Department. He will explain us why quantum QED waveguides are non-Markovian. Okay, I will tell you that you have 2 minutes left at the 10th minute, okay? Then 3 more minutes for questions. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Second. Yes, so thank you so much for like giving me this opportunity to talk. I'm very honored to be here. Let me start by saying that what I will talk about today is actually an example of how to do applied theory. When people say applied physics, people tend to think about experiments. And there is actually a theory that you can do and that's still inside applied physics, and this is one of them. And we will and my interest in this topic is not necessarily from quantum computing, but rather in the idea of emerging concepts from many-body interactions. So what happens when we put qubits together, right? And I'm also warning you at this point, so I will be discussing qubits as a theoretical construct, but you know, you can think of quantum dots, superconducting qubits, or MV centers as qubits. As long as something can be approximated as a qubit, we are fine. I took all the math away in this talk, so you need to provisionally trust me, and you can check my math afterwards from the papers. And finally, why I have a Turkish flag here, it's because this is 23rd of April, and I wanted to honor that tradition where, you know, you have a Turkish flag in TV today, because it's, you know, it's the sovereign day of Turkey. Yes, awesome. So let me start with the acknowledgement. So what I'm discussing today is basically a reinterpretation of the results we got 1.5 years ago, together with my thesis advisor for my master's, Egi, who is now a researcher at IBM Quantum. And I would like to thank her, because without her, none of this would have been possible. So you can actually just, after this talk, go ahead and look at this paper for the math that I will be discussing here. So let's start with the system model. So on the very high level, we have qubits, which are basically atoms with two levels. And then we have a bunch of them, and then they couple to an environment, which we, for the sake of simplicity, take to be a one-dimensional environment. And this is a waveguide for like practical purposes. If you want to do like an experiment of this, then this is a waveguide, right? And then these qubits, they actually have two states. So they have a ground state and an excited state, and then they have this resonant frequency. This frequency is the frequency of the pulse that you need to send to be able to excite this qubit, basically. And then they also have this decay rate, which is when you excite this qubit, how long it will take this qubit to decay, or in this case, inverse of the decay rate is that. So it's basically a time scale of the qubit's interaction, as well as it's also how strongly qubit interacts with incoming pulses as well. If it's a large value, then the qubit interacts with the pulses much strongly, but at the same time, if you excite it, it will decay much faster. And in this talk, we will be putting a bunch of the qubits together. They are going to be identical, and that's just for analytical convenience. We could look at non-identical qubits. And one important consequence here is there is no qubit-to-qubit interactions. All the interactions are going to be done via photons that are emitted from a single qubit to the waveguide, and then that gets scattered from another qubit and gets re-emitted and reabsorbed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So there is no direct interaction, only mediated through photons. And there are two time scales. One of them is the level separation or the resonance frequency, which is basically a very short time scale or very high frequency scale. And the other one is the decay rates, which are longer time scales where the actual, like the action happens, basically the time scale that we're interested in. And then they are also much lower frequency scales. So experimentally, omega is around gigahertz and gamma naught is around megahertz. And for the systems of our interest, omega is going to be much, much, much larger than gamma. So that means the pulse is basically interacting in a very narrow bandwidth. And if the distance between the qubits are much larger than the inverse decay rate, then we can think of them as isolated qubits. What does this mean? It means that the qubit, like if the qubit is excited, it will decay and send out a photon completely before that photon interacts with another qubit. And if the qubits are close to each other, the exact opposite happens. So before the qubit has a chance to send off the full photon wave function or like the full photon wave packet, the photon will start interacting with another qubit and gets reflected, and then it will basically create an interference on its own emission. So this is basically the region where the collective interactions happens. The qubits start to become like a collective unity that has some interesting properties, and this is where the interesting collective many-body effects appear. And there is this approximation, which is basically the reason why I'm giving you this talk. It's called the Markov approximation. And the approximation's main idea is that if the distance between the qubits is very, very small, then you can neglect the time that it takes a photon to propagate from one qubit to another qubit. So this is the physical picture. It's a very simple picture. And the mathematical picture, and this is the only time that I will discuss mathematics here, the full theory has, so the time dynamics of the full theory boils down to a set of differential equations, which also include time delays. And Markov approximation takes out the time delay and basically replaces it with the current status of the field. And that's what it means mathematically to the Markov approximation. Why do we do this? Because it's easier. Like, it's easier to solve the problem. It's basically possible to solve the problem because time delay differential equations are really hard to solve. On the other hand, ordinary differential equations are much, much easier to solve. But that's one part. So now let's talk about the decay rates, right? We said the qubits, when they are very, very close to each other, when the distance is very small, they start interacting and then they become a collective unity that has basically decay rates. And this whole unity has a slow time decay rates. And if there are n qubits, there are n decay rates corresponding to n different modes of the superposition of those qubits. And then there are these non-Markovian decay rates, and there are infinitely many of them. And why do we call them non-Markovian? Because they are for events which are happening very fast. And due to the fact that the time propagation inside the system between the qubits is very fast. Or in other words, it's like, if it's not negligible, but very fast, basically. So when you do the Markov approximation, these decay rates become infinity because they happen instantaneously. And this is an example of what it looks like to like calculate the decay rates. This is a complex plot. This is a complex plane. And then the roots of this complex, like this plot, are, or like the minimum values of this complex plots, are the decay rates. And these three decay rates correspond to the three slow time decay rates of three qubit system. And then you also start seeing these non-Markovian decay rates. The y-axis is the real part of the decay rate, and the x-axis is the complex imaginary part of the decay rate. And you can see that non-Markovian decay rates are much, much, much bigger. So the processes are happening much, much faster. For the purpose of this talk, I will be discussing the slow time decay rates because they are the interesting ones for us experimentally, because those are the processes that radiate outside to the qubit system. And we are looking at the outside of the qubit system, obviously. But again, I mean, we have like a 50, so this paper is like a 50 page long paper on the importance of decay rates and how to interpret them, yada, yada. So if you really want to talk about all the properties of decay rates, there will be enough time. And then let's discuss the emergence of many-body or like many-qubit effects. And for that, we will be looking at the decay rates. And remember, we are looking at those n small-time decay rates. So for a system with n qubits, and under a very specific condition that is called the Bragg-Miller condition or super-radiance condition, and it's actually, there are infinitely many of those conditions, n minus one of those decay rates become zero. What does this mean? It means that if you excite the qubits in a very specific way, in a very specific superposition, they will not decay outside of the system. The excitation will stay within the qubit system. Like one qubit will send the photon. So this is not really what's happening, right? This is just like me making a story of it. But basically the interference of the photons, that photon wave functions that are being emitted to the outside of the system will be destructive and there will be no radiation out. And that's called the bound state in continuum. And the one decay rate, which is like the one out of this n decay rate, and minus of them became zero, and the one of them becomes n gamma naught. What this means is all the n qubits, they come together and they create this one huge qubit, this one super qubit, which basically has a decay rate of all the qubits summed over. So it's a qubit that decays really fast. This means that all the qubits are decaying collectively. So their decay is enhancing the decay of each other. And this is actually a Markovian effect. This is an effect that we see when we apply Markov approximation, and it's called decay superradiance. It's like from 1950s, 1960s. It's a very well-known effect. So what happens when we are relaxing the Markov approximation, So when we are taking into account the finite qubit propagation time within the system is, so you are still seeing this n minus decay rate going to zero. So they are still, the bound states in continuum are still going to be there. But something weird happens to the decay super radiance. So think about it for a minute. You are separating the qubits from each other. So you would expect it would take a little bit more time for the qubits to decay. But what happens is the feedback of the photonic wave functions that are being emitted is aligned in such a way that the decay is actually increased. That's called super super radiance, and that's the paper is all about. So basically you get a decay rate which is stronger than decay super radiance, and the reason why it's stronger is because of the positive enhancement effect coming from the quantum coherent feedback. So it's a full quantum effect, it's a full non-Markovian effect. You wouldn't have this in a Markov approximation because you are basically ignoring all those feedbacks in a Markov approximation. So this was the main idea of that paper. And now I'm, oh, by the way, before I move on, also, if you are interested in this topic, in this idea of super radiance, check this paper out. They were like the first people to come up with the concept. It's a very, very interesting concept.
2 minutes, Fadi.
Yeah, thank you. This is my final slide. But at the time, we didn't really realize something, which is that this super, super radiance happens at a very, so actually we realized this, but we didn't realize the meaning of this. This super, super radiance effect happens at a very specific critical distance between the qubits, which scales down as the qubit number increases. What does this mean? It means that even if you think L is negligible, you still have non-Markovian effects in the large number, in the large qubit numbers, right? If you increase the qubit number, then you will still have non-Markovian effects, even though the distance between the qubits is small. And I'm going to do a back of the envelope calculation for you for like the parameters of nowadays experiments. And then this tells us that non-Markovian effects become non-negligible around 10 qubits. So if you are going to do any experiment that will include waveguides and qubits that are larger than 10, like qubit number that is larger than 10, then you can no longer do Markov approximation, which brings us to the topic, or you know, the final slide, which is also the first slide of this talk, that waveguide QED is inherently non-Markovian. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Gil. So, are there any questions? You can ask through the chat box, but in the meantime, I can ask. There is already one ready. This is your conclusion is about non-Markovian behavior or Markovianity. This is just a matter of number of qubits, you say. I mean, what about the physical other constraints? Is it just a number?
I mean, there are other constraints. This is more like an upper bound. Let's say like this is like the best state of the art technology we have. But I think the more physical concept is that no matter what type of qubits we will use, and no matter how good those qubits, like the numbers will be, there will always be a number of qubits after which we will no longer be able to apply this approximation. Mm-hmm. I mean, 10 qubits is with current number, but the numbers will change, but the theory is always there. And the scaling of the critical distance scales with n to the minus 2, which means whatever the prefactor changes are, which depends on the numbers that you put in, there will always be like this problem that you run into in terms of theory.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. There is a question from Özgür Hoca, Müstecaplıoğlu. You can also read if you want. Reading is more comfortable, but let me read it for everybody. Non-Markovian, can you see the question?
Yes.
Super radiance, has been discussed in photonic crystals. Mm-hmm. Any relation? He asks, is there any relation?
Yeah. We actually discussed this with Dr. Müstecaplıoğlu before. That's actually a very good question. The difference here is we are not really changing the physics, right? The super radiance or the super super radiance here comes from the fact that you are having this interference effects between the qubits. So as far as I know, maybe I'm wrong, in these cases, there's always something that's coming from outside, or you are either having a band effect, like the band, you are at the like near of the band gap, or like there is some other thing that where the qubits are decaying to. So it's basically there's something else that's mediating this. Here it's completely the qubits and the fact that there is constructive interference. And as for the scaling here, the scaling here is a bit m, so it's a linear scaling. It's not a n squared scaling.
Mm-hmm. There was a related question by Faruk Mirehvar about the scaling of super radiant case.
Yes, it's n, so it's with n. It's a linear scaling. It's as the p factor gets increased with respect to the decay super radiance. Yes, I am seeing the question. Would you like me to?
Okay. And if it is, if your answer is complete for Mirehvar, then you can move to Ceyhun Hoca's question, Ceyhun Bulutay.
Shouldn't there be a characteristic time scale that should come together with number of qubits? Exactly. There is. And that's the thing, right? The time scale. Exactly. So the time scale that you can do, right? The which will come from omega and gamma naught. That will change the number of qubits that you can apply the Markov approximation to, but after that number of qubits, the Markov approximation will no longer be applicable. And in this case, there are some more constraints, right? There are constraints that gamma naught is much, much smaller than omega, and then there's also the constraint that omega times L should be comparable to pi. So these are things that I haven't discussed, but these should be there for you to be able to see these type of physics. And these constraints, so these constraints are basically what basically makes me say that 10 qubits is probably going to be one of the like limits where we can do this.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we are done. Any questions? I think we have no more. Okay, thank you very much. We thank Fatih Dinç for this very nice and also the last presentation of our meeting.